shareholder here at Baker Donelson in the Tallahassee office, and I have been practicing employment law for 20 years. And one of the reasons I decided to do a webinar on social media is because it's like a locomotive right now. It is going so fast, and the law is chasing it to try to keep up with it. And I know that many of my clients and friends and businesses around that I deal with have had issues with it. And what can we do? Because it's a double-edged sword for employers. We love it and we hate it at the same time. So we're going to talk a little bit about today about how we use social media in hiring. We'll talk about social media policies, what the NLRB has said you can't have in your policies. And if you have any questions as we go along, you have a little question box, please feel free to type them. If I'm not answering it immediately, I will get to it. I'm planning on answering questions at the end, but if something comes up that I think is relevant while we're talking and a good point to get to, I will answer it during the time. And please indulge me a little bit because I'm sort of a PowerPoint junkie and I tried to do something a little fancy today. So I'm going to start with a quick intro and then we'll get to the meat of what we're talking about today. Okay, so our little friend deleted his picture of him in the bathtub with the beer, and I meant it as tongue-in-cheek, but one of the things we're going to talk about today is what happens when we find out some information like that about our employees or our applicants. You know, there's so many questions that have always been taboo during interviewing and on an application, but sometimes we can find that information if we're using social media as a recruiting tool. So we're talking about what is social media, and this picture always makes me laugh about the donut. You know, the Twitter is I'm eating the donut, and the Facebook guy is I like the donut, and then there's the person who actually posts the video of them eating the donut. And it's so prevalent now, and there's so many different avenues for employees to communicate, and it's not just a consumption of information anymore. Now, you know, everybody, their brother, their sister, their aunt, their cousin, their dog, my six-year-old are publishers. They can tweet and post and Snapchat and send information and post opinions and review your organization. And you know, how do we deal with that in the context of our employees? Of what can we do when somebody is saying something unkind about our organization or about an employee or their boss? How much control do we have? You know, not only that, we've got another issue of how often people are getting on to the internet and doing social media during working hours, whether through their own devices or through a device provided by the employer. One study said that, you know, Facebook alone is costing employers $28 billion a year in productivity loss. So that's another issue on top of all of this is we want oftentimes we utilize these social media, you know, social media in our workplace. I mean, it's a valuable tool for us, but what happens when it's being abused and how much control can we exercise, especially if someone is sitting at their desk and on their phone, not using your computer. So one of the things I want to just talk about to begin with is the fact that, you know, old laws, the laws that most of you deal with, you know, especially if you are in HR that you're dealing with on a day-to-day basis, they still apply. Because if you're getting your information even from social media, it doesn't matter. Notice is notice. So if you are on notice that somebody is a particular religion because you looked at their Facebook page and you take any action of it, even if you didn't ask it in an interview or put it on an application, you're still on notice. So all of those employment laws that come into play also come into play when you're utilizing social media in the workplace. So if you as an employer are taking any action based on something you're learning, you still need to keep in mind these protected classes and these laws that govern our workplace. If somebody announces on Facebook that they're pregnant but they haven't told you yet, which I actually have had happen with one of my clients, that they called and said, well, what do I do? You know, I found out through my assistant that so-and-so announced she was pregnant on Facebook but hasn't, you know, told us, and we haven't been able to do anything. You know, you can't unring a bell. You know it. You're on notice. And so you have to keep that in mind when you are working with employees and you're getting your information from a social media site. Another thing, and we're not going to talk about this in this is probably all I'm going to talk about this today because I think this is probably another seminar in and of itself, but you know, there are several companies that actually encourage their employees to use social media to promote the company. We have a local PR firm here in Tallahassee, and they encourage the people, their employees, when they're out and about, they all have a hashtag that they use that helps bring awareness to this PR firm. Well, there has been a lot of controversy about whether that's compensable time. If you're asking an employee or allowing an employee to do something that is promoting a product or a service of your company, and you're aware of it, it might possibly be compensable time. So it's something you might want to, if that's an issue, you may want to delve into that a little bit more to see. We're not going to talk about that in depth today, but I wanted to just point that out. Then on top of the standard employment laws, then we have all these laws, the First and Fourth Amendment, the Stored Communications Act, these laws that are governing emails and wiretaps and all this other communication that also kind of comes into play. And no one is saying that you need to know this or understand these laws, but I think it's just important to be on notice that they're out there. You know, the Stored Communication Act creates a right of privacy for email on the internet, and it really was against government seizure of getting that they can't just get your Gmail account and look at it without having a subpoena. That was the main purpose of it, but it has also come into play, and we'll talk about a little bit more in a little while, in an employment context. The Computer Fraud and Abuse Act is when you knowingly defraud someone through a computer, so you do a false profile or exceed the parameters or authorized access that the different social media set up, like the Facebook rules of presenting yourself as somebody that you're not. So these are all other considerations that kind of come into play when you are dealing with social media besides just the employment laws. So how are employers dealing with social media in the workplace? Well, my experience has found that there's been different gamuts of what people have done. So first, there are the people who say, you know, my clients would say to me, I'm just not letting them get on it, period. That's our rule. Nobody on the internet while you're at work, no one on social media. And sometimes that works, except that it's not realistic because, first of all, people are on it. Second of all, a lot of times, you know, I took a look at the organization, and we have a great group of people on this call today. We have public sector or private sector. We've got big corporations and some mom and pops, and regardless of what industry you're in or size, you know, most of you have Facebook pages or internet pages or, you know, websites or anything like that that are, you're utilizing the internet, and a lot of times an employee's job is that as well. So it's very difficult to just block it completely. Then there's ones that just allow everything. They don't monitor at all, and which is also can be extremely problematic, especially if you end up with some kind of claim of discrimination or harassment through one of the social media sites that you have no monitoring of it. No compliance where they have a detailed policy, and I've seen this a lot, where I'll talk to a client and they'll say, well, I have this great policy, and they'll show me the policy, and I'll talk to some of the managers, and no one knows it. They don't understand it. It's too long. I mean, we're living in the world of the tweet, you know, 140 characters. People want things short. They want to know what they have to do, what they don't have to do, and some of these policies are just so long and cumbersome that people don't, they sign off on them and don't really read them, and no one's doing training. So we're getting, you know, one of the things that I definitely promote is that when you have a social media policy, that your employees are trained on it. Then denial, you know, this is just a trick, you know, a phase. I'm not really worried about this. It's not really affecting my workplace. It's going to go away. It's just a phase. I don't think it's going anywhere. So what's the best response? It's everywhere. We know it's everywhere. So, you know, as an employer, we need to stay cutting edge. What are the new sites? What are people doing? You know, it's a constant evolution of what is out there. And it's something that employers need to be aware of, because, you know, there's this new app, WhatsApp, where you can get documents out in, you know, it's like a Snapchat. Well, you know, that's a concern for employers. Are documents of ours going out into cyber world without us being able to track it? So we need to be aware. It's everywhere. Also, it's not going anywhere. So we can't bury our head in the sand about this. This is definitely something that, you know, and the number of people who signed up for this webinar showed me, is it's definitely an issue in the workplace today. So what's the last thing we do? We embrace it. Okay, we say, okay, we know it's out there. How do we make it work for us? You know, first of all, we need to train our employees on proper use. What are we allowing within the parameters of our workplace? What is acceptable to us? Also, we have an official site, and we say on your official website that any other, you know, sites or you know, and we may have several. You might have a LinkedIn page for your organization. You might have a website. You might have a Facebook page, but that you document it as being the official site. So people know anything else is not an official word. It's not this company or this organization's, you know, this is not information that we are putting out. And also, we need to find the right fit. How are we using it? There's organizations where you're going to want your people to be on social media. You want them tweeting and taking pictures and Instagram and anything you can. And there's ones where you want it more controlled. And within the law that we're going to talk about, that is also an acceptable way to have in your workplace. I think before anything happens, you need to find what your organization's philosophy is and mission is regarding social media, because otherwise you're just kind of dancing in the wind. You need to be able to give some guidance to your employees that this is our philosophy of how we want to utilize social media, and this is the parameters that you are permitted to do it for our organization. So let's start with social media in hiring. Do we want to go surfing and go find out about this? It seems that a lot of you are doing it, that 91% of the employers surveyed in just a few years ago said that they were using social networking sites to screen applicants. And it's a very, very good way to screen applicants, because you're going to find out information that you might not necessarily get in an application. I mean, you're going to get insight into their activities, their work history, their personality. whether it be messages or pictures they post. You can find out their job history from LinkedIn, and does that match up with the resume that they presented or the application. There's just a myriad of information that you can glean from an individual's social media activities. And, you know, no one's resume lists getting drunk on my front porch as an interest. You might go on their Facebook page and find that getting drunk on their front porch is pretty much their sole leisure activity. And is that relevant to what you're looking for in an employee? So there's certainly benefits in utilizing this technology. Also, it's good for, you know, when you're talking about a lawsuit. If somebody's claiming emotional distress and they have emoticons and pictures of them dancing and having fun and, you know, all happy on their Facebook page, then that can be used as evidence to refute an emotional distress claim. It also can be used in a sexual harassment case where somebody's saying something was subjectively offensive or that it was unwelcomed, and we find flirtatious, you know, exchanges on Facebook. It can definitely be helpful. But one of the things you do want to watch, just like I had said earlier, is that these employment laws still apply. And so we need to be careful of how we're using it in hiring. So the first one is, you know, one of the things I thought was really interesting, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but I found this Career Builder survey, and they were talking about, you know, how are, you know, when they're using social media, what are they looking at? And that things that hurt an employee were that they had provocative pictures, they posted them drinking or using drugs, poor communication skills. I thought it was funny that they used text language in an email or application was one of the reasons that someone wasn't hired, but you know, that they lied about their background. They found an inconsistency in their background on social media versus what they told them they had done. So there are several things that are utilized from, so this is a good example of how social media is used to screen out a candidate and also to help a candidate. You know, that they found that the profile provided good information of their personality, their fit, that they showed them, you know, or talked about some of their professional things that they were doing, maybe posted pictures of some of the professional things they were doing, maybe speaking or something in the community, showed their communication skills. So it's definitely, these are examples of how someone's social media can actually be a tool for a recruiter or HR. So what is the risk? Well, the biggest risk is when you're not using social media consistently. So when you are inconsistent or arbitrary, that sometimes we're looking at Facebook pages, sometimes we're not, sometimes we'll go to a Twitter account, sometimes we don't, it depends, this is where it'll come back to haunt you. You know, there was one case that happened a while ago, but it was interesting to me because the employer was saying that they were moving for summary judgment. They were saying to the court that the case should be thrown out because the person did not show religious discrimination. And he was saying, well, look, I was a top candidate. You know, and in this case, the employer argued we didn't know their religion. And he wrote, you know, he was able to show that they looked at his Facebook page and that it was, his religion was all over his Facebook page, so they couldn't claim ignorance of his religion, because that Facebook, he had given them authority to go onto his Facebook page. So if they look and can show that you're looking at some online profiles of some applicants and not others, it can be evidence of discrimination. And if it's used in a particular way, so you need to be very careful about how you're doing this and how consistently you're doing it. You know, what are you going to say when you're saying, why did you look at one person versus another? Why isn't that our consistent pattern? And sometimes, you know, what I always tell my clients is you always want to be consistent, and if you're going to go off course, that you have a legitimate reason for doing it. And maybe sometimes you do. Maybe sometimes you have a legitimate reason that, you know, if I see an inconsistency between an interview and a resume, we'll go do an additional search or something like that, that you have another reason of when you go to social media, that's fine. But you want to make sure that you have a very neutral criteria for when you're utilizing it, if you're not utilizing it every time. So what happens also when we learn too much information? You know, sometimes you'll go onto a Facebook page and say, I don't know if I really wanted to know this about the person, which is why sometimes we don't ask questions in an interview, because we just want to get information that's really relevant to the job, and we don't really want a person's complete personal history. So, you know, one of the things you have to be careful is the things that we don't ask, you know, you don't ask somebody's age or medical condition on an application or on in an interview, but you may find it out in doing a Facebook search or, you know, looking at someone's Twitter account or MySpace or any of the other social media. So we have to be really careful about that, because it's just like asking them the question. And if you view it and you get that information, you can't say, well, we didn't know, kind of going back to that religious discrimination. You know, they couldn't say, we didn't know your religion, and he's like, it was all over my Facebook page. So, yes, you did know my religion. So some of the things that we try to keep ourselves purposely ignorant of as an employer, when you delve into the world of social media, especially in this day and age where people say, you know, post a status, I woke up this morning, and then the next status is I had breakfast and I ate 2 eggs and bacon, and you're hearing every little aspect of somebody's life, you may get more information than you want. So we have to be careful about that. So to post or not to post. So an HR manager posts a job opening on an employer's Facebook site. Is this a problem? Probably not. HR managers are using Facebook to recruit now. The problem is, though, is that they only use it for Facebook to post, because there might be a potential disparate impact claim that not everybody has access to a computer or the internet on a regular basis, and you are might be excluding a protected group by limiting it to social media. So I think if you have, your organization has a Facebook page, I don't see any reason why you can't post. I think it's a good source for recruiting. I just wouldn't have it be your only place that you post. You want to make sure that you're posting in several different spots. So what about when somebody comes in and is telling you, you know, Jane, you're interviewing Jane, and she's telling you what a fabulous singer she is, and that's a hobby of hers, and suggests you go to her YouTube page, and you haven't gone to anybody else's, checked anybody else's YouTube page. And you find out that Jane's a fabulous singer, but she only sings in strip clubs or something like that. You know, and is there information that you're getting from that that you might use? Is that a problem? Probably not. You know, if somebody is guiding you there and then you find information, but once again, you know, one of the things that we want to be careful of is being consistent in our use of it. And also to make sure, you know, my recommendation is that to have a third party do your screening. Now, that's not feasible for everyone, I get it. It's not feasible to have an outside organization do your social media screening. So if that's not feasible, my second suggestion is that you have somebody removed from the decision-making doing the screening. So maybe you have not the HR director, but an HR manager who's in charge of screening, and that screening is limited to certain areas that you are having them look for related to the job. So, you know, is the candidate, you know, does the candidate display good judgment? Might be a question you're asking. You know, if somebody's in a healthcare field and you're looking at their things, have they shown disrespect or for their patients in the past? Have you seen anything in their posts that talk about their patients in a disrespectful way? There was a case where a teacher had been posting really nasty things about her students, and her termination was upheld as, you know, as being violative of the school's policy. So, you know, if it's geared toward the job, and you might want to give that person who's doing it some criteria of what you're asking them to look for. So you're not just blanket snooping, that is geared toward the job. So what about friending someone on Facebook so you can see more of their profiles? And I know that, you know, in this day and age, we're working, we're at the workplace a lot. We become friends with our coworkers and the people who work for us, but it is not a good idea to be friends with subordinates on social media. And also, it's also a problem when you're doing it for an applicant. I don't recommend it. I think it ends up, if you're not doing it for everybody, you can have that kind of claim against you. And also, once again, if you're getting information, that too much information, we're going back to the too much information that you're finding out the person's getting drunk on the front porch every day and that bothers you, and you're using that information, it may be more than you want. So, and also, if somebody feels pressure, especially an employee, to accept it, and then if they don't accept your friend request, is that going to be a problem, and can it be retaliatory, discriminatory? They'll say that you didn't treat them right after they, you know, dissed you when you were trying to become their friend, Facebook friend. So I just say as a blanket rule, it's probably better to avoid being friends with your anyone who reports to you. And then for the last one, you know, an HR purchases a social media background check on an applicant and does not hire her based on what he finds, he sends her a nondescript rejection letter only. Is that a problem? You know, that's going to be, this is a gray area of whether these background checks come under the Fair Credit Reporting Act. There is quite a bit of opinion out there that they do, and that the same kind of reporting requirements as a criminal background check, if you're doing a third party, having a third party do a social media background check and you're utilizing that information not to hire someone, that you're going to have to do the same type of disclosures that you would under the FCRA for a criminal background check or a credit background check. So that's another thing to keep in mind if you are having a third party do it. Okay, so, and here's just, this one's been kind of going around. This is a post of a friend, somebody who had befriended their boss, and the boss saw that someone had posted something not very nice about it, and he fired her. So probably another reason not to be friends with your subordinates. This one was very colorful. There's lots of colorful words under the blackout, if you can imagine. So what are the best practices? Let's screen all applicants in a uniform manner. Have a protocol of what you're doing, and if it's written, even better. Also, if you can have a neutral party screen the information, that's great. And the neutral party can be outside or internal, but somebody who's not directly involved in the decision-making aspect of that hiring. Search for information that's job-related. So when we're going to look on social media, we're not just randomly kind of snooping, that we're looking for particular things. Maybe it be their communication style, their character, maybe something looked a little awry in their background, and we want to see kind of what the postings are, if it gelled with what they told us or what they presented to us. I usually recommend that social media reviews are done after the interview and before the hire. It's a great time to kind of confirm what they told you. Don't create false personas to gain access to information, which I don't think anyone on here would do, but it is a crime. Also, we don't friend applicants to gain access to non-public profiles. And one of the things that I find that's going to be more and more important as we go forward is to document the information that's discovered. If you find something where someone, especially when someone has presented information either in an interview or on an application or on a resume that you have found not to be true through social media, that you're printing the page and putting it with their employment packet to document where you're basing your conclusion that they were not honest in their presentation of information to you. And then also, we want to consider the credibility of the source, because there's a lot of information out there on social media that is inaccurate. So it may be, you know, especially if you like somebody that you've interviewed and you're finding something that doesn't jive, you're probably your best bet is to go back to them with the information and let them, you know, at least be aware of it. And also just to be advised of the law, because as I said earlier, there's lots of layers of things that apply when we're dealing with social media in the workplace and outside the workplace. So we want to make sure you just have a working knowledge that, ooh, I might have a problem here and need to get somebody on the phone. Now, password requesting has been an interesting thing. It died in Florida last year. It didn't go anywhere, but it's back up and it's in committee right now. There's been two attempts to pass a federal law that would prohibit employers from requesting a password to a personal internet account. Now, if an employee has a password to an account that is under the employer's name of some sort, that's not what these laws apply to. But 19 states have them now. There's 28 states that, including Florida, that are passing them. I don't think the federal government's going to get involved now because the states are taking care of it. So it's died twice in federal, in Congress, so I don't see it going anywhere there. But I think we're going to see pretty much every state have it soon. It has a lot of momentum right now. So we don't want to ever force access by requesting the username or password or force our connection by requesting friending. That's just a good rule of thumb as we go forward. And then I had to tell you guys this case because I thought it was funny. A nun guessed one of their employees' Gmail password and access to his account and then found all this stuff on it she didn't like and terminated him. The court found that it was a violation of the Stored Communications Act, that she didn't have a right. She didn't have a permission to access that information. So we don't want to be guessing people's passwords, and even if they don't tell them to us. Does anyone right now have any questions about hiring, social media and hiring? Okay. Good. We're doing good. All right. So next we're going to talk about the NLRA. You know, and historically people have heard, especially employers, and we've got a lot of seasoned HR people on the call, that, you know, we don't deal with the National Labor Relations Act because, we don't have a union. Well, the NLRB, the National Labor Relations Board, is on a kick right now. The NLRB and the EEOC have just been, in my 20 years of doing employment law, I have never seen them so active. And the NLRB's on this kick right now on addressing employers that have non-union employees, that do not have unions, because the requirements under the NLRA apply to them as well. And so we're going to talk a lot about them because they have weighed in very heavily in social media. But, you know, as far as social media policies go, they're on the rise. You know, everybody's using them. They've got them. They're used to either curb misrepresentation of the business, that they want to stop the employees from saying too much and or saying something inaccurate about the business. They're trying to target non-business use of social media at their workplace, or they're trying to stop harassment disparaging comments about the business or employees. We're seeing a lot of social media policies, but the problem is, as I talked earlier, some of these policies are just voluminous and are really kind of dead policies. I always talk about handbooks as being active live documents. You know, if your handbook is not something that people aren't pulling out and looking at and quoting, then it's not a live document. It might be too long, or we're not training our employees, because we want to make sure we don't have something in paper that says, this is our philosophy, this is our rule, this is our policy, that's not actively applied to the workplace. We don't want dead policies. So we, especially with social media policies. So let's talk a little bit about the NLRB, because we're going to talk about, I want to address what the NLRB has said about these policies, because I think you'll be very surprised at what the NLRB has said is an unlawful policy. I was. So they've had an increased interest in social media policies. And basically what they are relying on is Section 7 of the National Labor Relations Act that says that employees shall have the right to self-organization, to form, join, or assist labor organizations, to bargain collectively through representatives of their own choosing, and to engage in other concerted activities for the purpose of collective bargaining or other mutual aid and protection. The key word here is concerted activity. You know, what can two or more employees do that is considered a concerted activity that will be protected by the National Labor Relations Act? And I can tell you, as I sit here today, that the National Labor Relations Board has a very broad view of what that is. So we're going to talk first about General Motors policy that the NLRB absolutely hated. They thought this was the worst policy ever. And I'm going to talk, I pulled out some of the key parts of the policy. So the first phrase of the policy that the NLRB couldn't stand was, be sure that your posts are completely accurate and not misleading, and that they do not reveal non-public company information at any public site. Seems pretty logical, straightforward. We're telling them make sure they're accurate, that you're not misleading, that you're not revealing anything that's not a public, that's public information. The NLRB said, nope, we don't like that. The term completely accurate and not misleading is overbroad because it would reasonably be interpreted to apply to discussions about or criticisms of the employer's labor policy. Okay, so for some reason the NLRB seemed to think that because we're saying it has to be completely accurate, that that eliminated opinion, and that we can't have any policy that will chill an employee's ability to criticize the employer. So an employer's labor policy and its treatment of employees would be protected by the act so long as they're not maliciously false. So false isn't good enough. It has to be maliciously false, which I would love to tell all of you what maliciously false means. I'm not exactly sure, except that I guess it's an intent to purposely say something that's not true versus just saying something that's not true. Another part of the GM policy that the NLRB didn't like says non-public information includes personal information about another employee, such as his or her performance, compensation, or status in the company. They're saying we don't want our employees posting information about another employee in terms of their pay, performance. NLRB says, well, an employee can construe that as precluding them from discussing the terms and conditions of employment. So if somebody's paid more than I am and I'm protesting it and saying my employer's unfair, this policy doesn't let me do that, so it's a violation of the NLRA. I mean, this is how nitpicky they have been. It's crazy. Okay, so then the next one. Do not incorporate employer logos, trademarks, or other assets into your posts. You think that would also be fair? Nope. Employees' non-commercial use of the logo or trademark while engaging in Section 7 activities would not infringe on the employer's interest. So they basically did not like this policy at all. They felt that this policy did not had a chilling effect on GM employees from criticizing GM. That was their conclusion of this policy. Now, also Dish Network, they didn't like Dish Network's policy either. Dish says, you may not make disparaging or defamatory comments about employer, its employees, officers, directors, vendors, customers, partners, affiliates, and or their products or services, okay? So nothing disparaging or defamatory. Well, saying something defamatory is illegal, so you'd think that this would be okay, but it was disparaging that they didn't like. The prohibition about making disparaging or defamatory comments is unlawful because it's again, construed to apply to protected criticism, that an employee needs to be able to criticize their employer, and that is part of a concerted activity that is protected by the National Labor Relations Act. Okay, now, believe it or not, now they liked Walmart's policy, and I don't want to say this because it make it sound like, oh, Walmart had a walk in the park. Actually, Walmart didn't. They didn't like Walmart's policy at first, but they picked on it, and Walmart rewrote their policy, and the new policy Vanessa Labor Relations Board liked. And it says, prohibits inappropriate postings that may include discriminatory remarks, harassment, and threats of violence or similar inappropriate or unlawful conduct. This was found to be narrow enough to be upheld by the National Labor Relations Board. Always be fair and courteous to fellow employees and others. Now, while this was upheld, it would be interesting to me to see if somebody was terminated for a social media post that under this provision where they're criticizing another employee. Because I believe the National Labor Relations Board would find that to be a criticism of the terms and conditions of employment. So you have to be careful, even though this was allowed, of how it's applied. And prohibits communications that reasonably could be viewed as malicious, obscene, threatening, or intimidating. Again, narrow enough. And then the Walmart policy gave examples, and the NLRB loved this. They might be include offensive posts meant to intentionally harm someone's reputation or posts that could contribute to a hostile work environment on the basis of race, sex, religion, or other protected status. They gave several examples of posts that would be violative. And the NLRB said, you know, this policy is not ambiguous because it provides sufficient examples of what's prohibited. And it says that employees would not be couldn't read this to prohibit Section 7 activity. So at the end of the day, what is, you know, and I have a ton of these. We could spend, you know, all afternoon on the NLRB's, you know, very crazy, in my opinion, opinions on this. But what, at the end of the day, is their conclusion? And this is what they've given three guidance on this, and based on their law, on their rulings, based on the guidance and the rulings, here's what I have kind of gelled it down to, okay? They don't like overbroad social media policies. And what does that mean? First, they don't like things that would be like something that would embarrass or harass or defame. That it's too subjective. What would embarrass me or you or the company, would embarrass one company? They don't like that, okay? The lack truthfulness or could damage goodwill, they don't like that. As I said before, they want maliciously false because they feel that in an opinion you can say something that somebody could say, well, that's not true, and you should be able to give your opinion under Section 7. That they don't like anything that says you're not allowed to talk about company business on your personal account because they have the right to do so under the NLRA Section 7. They have a right to criticize an employer and also post things that can be construed as inappropriate. They don't like the word inappropriate. They think it's too subjective. So overbroad social media policies they don't like. So what do they like? They like when you have specific examples, maliciously false comments, engaged in unlawful harassment under our policies. They like when you circle back to your policy. So if you have a ethics policy, if you have a harassment policy, if you're saying in your social media policy that you are not allowed to post anything that could possibly be considered violative of our harassment or our ethics policy or our confidentiality policy, they like that. If you can circle back around to your other policies. Also, including an NLR disclaimer, which is that nothing in this policy shall be construed to limit an employee's rights under Section 7. But this alone is not enough because there's been policies that they have struck down that had the language. But it helps. And may limit contact with the media on behalf of the company. You can say that you may not represent yourself in public on social media or to the media as a representative of the company, and you need to disclose that you are not speaking on behalf of the company. You can also restrict employees from discussing, they called it embargoed information, so things that are protected by law under law, HIPAA, personal health information under HIPAA, social security numbers, things that are protected by law. You can restrict them from discussing. they are saying the protected activity that they are protecting are complaints about the way the company conducts business, the way it generally treats its employees, and the company's culture or morale. So if they're talking about what they, what the key words that the NLRB always goes to are, they are allowed to discuss the terms and conditions of employment. So anything that, that is construed as the terms and conditions. But what they can't do is just gripe. You know, unprotected activity includes personal gripe. There was a case of an ER worker, EMT, I'm sorry, and she is posting about how her the other EMT is picking his teeth, and it's bothering her. And she keeps posting it and posting it and posting it. And then they pick up a child, and she posts that she thought that the child was autistic. And the court and the NLRB said, no, you know, that's not protected. You're just griping. You're not talking about a term and condition of employment. They had a right to terminate you based on that post. So personal gripes of I don't like this, but you just had to be careful because I don't like this. If it's I don't like this, that is a term and condition of employment. It's a fine line. Excessive obscenities or inappropriate racist, although there was a case that was upheld where somebody called an employee tweeted that her employer was a douchebag, and they found that that was not an excessive obscenity. So excessive has to be pretty excessive, I guess. Also, it's kind of interesting, there was a case out of the NLRB recently where it was found that a like on a Facebook was a protected activity, not even a comment. A like was a protected activity. So it's very, very broad where the NLRB is going with this. But complaints would focus on a company's products or business policies. They have said is okay, but I still say it's a fine line between that and what a term and condition of employee. So how do we draft a policy? What do we do with given all this craziness that's out there? Well, the basics of creation, then we're going to talk about implementation and education, monitor and stay vigilant, and the updates. So first, step one, what are the considerations? We can have prohibitions on use of social media that are disrespectful, inflammatory, offensive, dishonest, damaging to the company's reputation. This is still okay. We just need to make sure the language still allows for criticism of, you know, valid criticism of the employer without being maliciously false. The content shouldn't include slurs, personal insults, obscenity, or anything to tarnish the image. And the prohibitions company trade secrets of financial information, things that are protected by the law, are still protected and can be protected in the social media policy. You know, also, you can have a requirement that an employee who expresses their opinions and they have something on their social media page that identifies where they work, that they put a disclaimer saying that the views expressed are not are mine alone and don't necessarily reflect the views of my company, my coworkers, et cetera, the customers. You can require that as part of your social media policy. Also, we can have time, place, and manner restrictions because during working hours, you can tell them that they can't get on social media or how they can do it in the context of their working hours that you're paying for. But we want to be careful that the restrictions are as narrow as they can be while still protecting us. And how do we make it work? You know, we want to make sure this is just like any other employment policy you have. You want to make sure it's written, it's well disseminated, and we have signed acknowledgments that the employees know this is what your policy is. Update other policies such as harassment policies to fit in with it. Have them cross-reference it. Make sure that you're talking about in your sexual harassment or anti-harassment policy that you're talking about harassment via social media or texting or anything like that. That that your policies are changing with the time. Encourage employees to use common sense about how they use and think about social media. You want to talk to your employees about it. And, you know, that to make sure you're getting the message out that you can't unring the bell. You know, things can't be deleted. You know, that picture is out there. Even if you take it out, somebody can have it still. And we want to train our employees on the social media platforms. The policies are that are designed to address and how we'd like them to use it, and especially if we're encouraging our employees to use it, because some, you know, social media can be a wonderful tool for an organization, and if we're encouraging our employees to use it, we want to make sure we're training them as well. So monitoring vigilance, you know, all standard procedures still apply. You know, you have the right to monitor your computers and what people are accessing in terms of the internet and your Facebook and your email policies, but we want to make sure we're articulating the infractions, that we're disciplining consistently, we're documenting appropriately, that we're using this document as a live document, as I was talking about before, in a consistent manner, that we're monitoring publications about your company that appear on public sites, that people outside of the company can see. You know, do a Google alert of your company, and it's free, you know, anytime. Or the key people in your organization, you'll get a notice every time there's anything out there in the public domain in terms of articles that address it or mention your organization. Determine the extent that the internal monitoring systems such as spam filters, web traffic monitors, and firewalls are needed. I think this is definitely an age where those things are very important in terms of privacy as well. You know, we've heard so many privacy breaches lately, and so that aspect is important for that too. And discuss and learn from employees. You know, maybe employees have good ideas on how to better monitor this and how to utilize social media to your benefit. And so you want it to be a conversation with them. And also, you know, as far as the last step, this is so important because I think when I started today, I said, this is a locomotive. I mean, it is just barreling forward. And every day there's new changes, there's new apps, there's new access, there's new issues. And, you know, we want to make sure your policies and your practice stay in line with that. You know, look at your policy. Is it effective now? You know, are they still current? Are they talking about everything as cutting edge as it needs to be? You know, and is it still lawful? You know, the law is changing. You know, there's legislation in 28 states right now on the password. You know, is it still in compliance with the law? And what has this affected on productivity, morale, et cetera, in how we're approaching this? In terms of how structured we are with our what we're allowing on social media through our employees. And at the end of the day, what can we do? We need to maintain consistent protocols on screening applicants and social media profiles and information regarding their protected class. And if we can have a third party do it, we'd like to have a third party do it. If not, somebody internally that we can isolate and not have be part of the decision-making process and limit their searches to something that is job-based. We're looking for, and it could be, you know, that doesn't mean we're not still looking at what they're posting and doing, but job-based could be, I want to see, you know, what she is posting about in terms of her communication, in terms of how she's presenting herself, and does she seem to have a consistent. She's told us that she's worked for the same place for many, many years. Was she critical of them? You know, things that might be related to the new job or are related to the new job. We want to develop a basic understanding of the activities that are protected by the NLRA, and mostly that is, you know, that an employee has a right to And there's been a case now that they can actually use your email system for it, but they have the right to organize and to collectively, you know, promote an issue, and they also have a right to state an opinion about terms and conditions of employment. We only want to make sure we're accessing private employee information with authorization. You know, and as I was saying before, we may have an issue if you're using a third party to do social media checks, but you might need a Fair Credit Reporting Act waiver. We want to comply with the terms of the websites themselves and ensure that employment decisions are made with accurate information, because false or misleading information is pretty common on this. And we want to make sure we're being careful about retaliatory actions against protected activities. So that's the key points on this. I know we've kind of brushed the surface of a lot of things, but if I can give you a takeaway from any of this, I think that you're not prohibited from taking action against an employee based on a social media post, but you have to be careful with it, and we have to look at it in the terms of the NLRA and the terms of your social media policy. And so the best place to start is your social media policy. Is it in compliance? Is it a live document? Do our employees understand it and know it, and know what they're allowed to do and what they're not allowed to do? Does anyone have any questions? Well, thank you so much for being part of this. We're doing monthly seminars, and if anyone has a topic they would like us to discuss, we'd love to hear about it, and we would be happy to do a seminar on it. So just let us know. My email is there. I also, of course, because I am on social media a lot, gave you my LinkedIn and my Twitter account. So any way you want to communicate with me, just let me know. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day.